Okay, everybody, let's get started again. Okay, this is what we did. I want to talk about causality now. The idea of causality is of course very old already. Galileo made some description about that, but the principle boils down to it that the effect cannot precede the cause. So the ball will not start rolling before I kick it. And in an EM situation, that means the response to an electromagnetic wave, so the response to illumination, light, the response cannot travel faster than the speed of light itself. So the effect cannot precede the cause, it follows the cause. Then early 20th century, a lot of thinking about this went into this. Heisenberg said that the idea itself wasn't so bad, but the premise that that we know the present in order to predict the future was wrong. That's of course his famous uncertainty principle. So a lot of ideas were developed around that time. This is a 1929 conference, scientific conference in I don't know where. Which basically has a lot of famous physicists in attendance there. I've looked up the names. We have Pauli. We have, for example, Casimir. We have Niels Bohr is there. There is a Darwin. That's not Charles Darwin. It's a nephew of Charles Darwin. Paul Ehrenfest is there, and a few more or less famous other names. Two I've indicated in red, these are Kramers and Kronig. I already hinted a little bit at the Kramers-Kronig equations, that they are both the namesake of. So this basically this the mathematical formalism of this was all developed in the early 20th century. So what is it? What does it mean mathematically? So if we have a physical system that is responding to some input, and then we can write the response as a convolution integral of the input, so the signal that is incident on the system, and some kind of causal response function. So if you look closely at this integral, it tells you that the response at a certain time t is a weighted sum of the input. So if the input is still lasting, then that it still counts. So all the previous inputs count to build up the response at a certain time t, but also the integral runs from zero to t, so it cannot start earlier. The response only starts at the time that the input starts. This is a convolution integral. I assume that you're familiar with that, so I'm not going to go too much into that. This is a real. The real physical system. So all these quantities here in this equation are also real functions. So RFT is a real function. The input is a real function, and the causal function itself in the time domain is real. But if we transfer Fourier transform to the frequency domain, then it can be a complex function. So the Fourier transform of Z of T is then Z of omega, which has a real part X of omega and an imaginary part Y of omega. Now causality dictates, and we'll see that a little bit later on, but this is already the giveaway. Causality will dictate that there is a relation between the real and imaginary part of Z omega. So if I take this causal response function, this system function, but consider it in the frequency domain where it has real and imaginary components, then there is a relation between this real and imaginary component. And these relations are the Kramers-Kronig relations. So that is what these two people gave us. We'll see that we can write a Kramers-Kronig relation for the complex refractive index. I'll get to that property in a moment. And that will also imply, and that it's a little bit of a bad joke, of course, but it will imply sort of that the refractive index is the only property. If you know the refractive index, you can basically calculate all optical properties. So it is kind of the one property to rule them all. Enough with the jokes. A good physics class starts with Maxwell's equations, so I could not resist. Here we go. You're familiar with these, so I'm not going to spell them out. We have electric field, we have magnetic field, and the constants in there, the material properties, are the permittivity and the permeability. So electric and magnetic properties. We can solve, we can cleverly combine these equations and get to a second order differential equation for the electric field, the so-called wave equation, the solution of which I should say is the so-called wave equation. In order to get there, you can try cosine and sine functions of a traveling wave in space and in time. So the generic description of that would be given as here in the slide. We have wave number there, k equal to 2 pi over lambda, where lambda is the wavelength, and phi is the argument for time, is the propagation velocity of this wave, of this traveling wave. It's expressed in sines and cosines, so it has an amplitude and a phase, which means that we can and we will use the complex notation of this field, so amplitude exponential I times a certain phase term. Okay, well, let's regroup that a little bit. We can bring k into the brackets, so we have k times r and k and the product of k of phi. We'll define that as omega, so we can rewrite as a, again still as a cosine and sine functions, but now with split spatial and time dependence, and that allows us to redefine or recreate the velocity of the wave as omega over k. And if we fill this in the wave equation, we can solve that, and we find that the velocity of the wave is given by, so if we fill the sines and cosines in the wave equation on top, that the velocity of the wave is 1 over the square root of the permeability and the permittivity. So the velocity of an EM wave in the material is determined by these properties. Now it's convenient to split these properties in values for vacuum in red here, that these are denoted by a sub zero, sub naught, and values for a material that are specific for a material. They are called then the relative permittivity and the relative permeability. And these are actually the material properties. So we can do the same thing then with the velocity of the wave. We can split that into a value for vacuum and a value for a material. The wave velocity in vacuum has its own symbol c, and then the remainder part that is related to the material properties, to the relative permittivity and permeability, is called has symbol m, like this, and this m is the refractive index. So m is the square root of the relative permeability and the relative permittivity. And we will see later on that mu r in most materials is very close to 1. So the approximation m is the square root of epsilon r is usually what is used. All right. Important, very important to keep in mind that this refractive index is not a constant. It is a function of omega or of the wave number or the wavelength, whatever description is most suitable at the moment. But it is a function of it is a function of frequency. Well, for completeness, this electromagnetic wave is then consistent of an electric field and a magnetic field, which are perpendicular to each other, and the direction of propagation is perpendicular to them both. So that is what the outer product signals. The magnitude of the wave vector is related to wavelength, 2 pi over lambda. Lambda is the wavelength, the color of the light. And then again, also for completeness, I'm going to work to intensity, the thing that we can actually measure. Intensity, or in an electromagnetic textbook, it would be probably called the pointing factor. We can calculate it by taking the outer product of E and B again, and then with some scaling. So we can see now that, again, through this outer product, that I, the intensity factor or the pointing factor, is in the direction of K. So that is the direction in which energy is transferred in the, for the traveling wave. The amplitudes of E and B are proportional, so we can write at least for the magnitude of the intensity that it is proportional to E squared. And here are some examples of typical intensities that you can find. Okay, then finally, the notation of variance. So usually we write something like intensity is proportional to e squared, to the magnitude of e squared. Sometimes there has to be spatial or temporal averaging, so then an extra set of brackets occur. And in other cases, it is more convenient to write the intensity as the product of E with its complex conjugate. They are all equivalent. They all yield the same answer. All right. So the solution to Maxwell's equation is then a plane wave which travels in this as it is written here in the r direction. So E of r, the vector k is the wave vector omega is frequency. Is given in complex notation as this amplitude and then an exponential term. It has m, the refractive index, as a complex quantity, so it has a real part n of omega and an imaginary part kappa of omega. So my question is now, if this is the electric field, can you now write can you expand this? Well, that's not too difficult. So using the complex refractive index in this expression for the field, and then the other question is, what is now the final expression for the intensity? The question is, can you have a quick go at that? Yorick has an answer in the chat, indeed. And then for the intensity, so wait a little.
Jorik, why isn't there a minus omega t part in the first exponent?
Since I separated the exponents, so you can write so for example the exponent of alpha plus b, you can also write that as exponent alpha times exponent b.
Yeah, I get that, but shouldn't there also be a minus omega t part in first exponent with the kappa?
So no, since I multiply by every component in the exponent by I, so I get an exponent with three terms. You get the n omega times kr, the kappa times omega times kr, and a minus omega t. And in my answer, I split this exponent with three terms. I split it in an exponent with one term, the kappa omega kr, and an exponent with two terms. Yeah, it's a bit hard to to explain. Maybe if I can share my screen, I can draw something to make it a bit more clear. Let's see. I'm still used to Zoom, so now it's...
Yeah, I'm not sure if you can, but you can try. It's that's great.
I mean, I have done this earlier in one of your lectures, but I completely forgot. Here we go. Okay, is it sharing?
No, but maybe I have to stop first.
I'll stop.
Let's say okay.
Okay,
there you go. Try it.
Okay. Nu ben ik weer de knop om het delen te vinden kwijt. Nu presenteer je volledig scherm. There we go. Heb ik toestemming om te delen?
Geen idee. Voor mij mag je, maar ik krijg geen verzoek binnen. Dus ik dacht dat ik...
Sorry.
Ja, okay. Daar gaat het.
Even kijken. Nou, we gebruiken even een pen. Dus we hebben... Dit mag gewoon zwart. We hebben de exponent met i. En dan vullen we... Ik vul nu m in. Dus dat is n omega plus i kappa omega. Ik heb hier volgens mij nog een tweede set aan haakjes nodig. Dan hebben we k in product r. Even kijken. Dit is het gedeelte. Is er een pen? En we hebben min omega t. Dus ik heb hier alleen de substitutie gedaan. Als je nu dit gedeelte uitwerkt. En dit gedeelte hier. Dat krijg je i. En omega. Excuses voor het handschrift. K keer r. Je krijgt min kappa omega k keer r en min i omega t. So far so good?
Yep, pause me on.
Okay. A different way of writing this is just let me select this and duplicate. Is to write it like. A different way to do this. Oh, game.
You was. Oh, you had him bijna.
Yeah. Okay. This looks a bit odd, but this is a different way to write it, and I think in the answer I wrote down in the chat instead of an extra I used the brackets here.
Yep.
So these two things are exactly the same. And it also explains why there's an omega t in this part of the exponent and it's absent here. Does that answer your question, Micah?
Yeah, I'm sorry. When I worked it out myself, I got the same. So, but thank you for a clarification.
Okay. Has someone else put down the intensity? Because else I can just write this down, I guess, since I have it open anyways.
Okay.
So we have I.
I had in the chat, but I wasn't sure about prefactor. So.
No, but I should have said that. But usually we just simply omit that prefactor. So don't bother with the.
Yeah, you should have said it earlier. I've already written it down. And there's the two here.
Yeah.
And this part cancels since you multiply with the complex conjugates.
That's the easiest way to do it in this case. Then all the complex terms drop out, and the rest is just squared. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then I give the screen back to you.
Gracias. Yeah. There we go. Okay. Yeah. So first the expression of the field. Indeed, I made the same separation as you did, Jorik. So you have a term first that looks very much like the expression that we had. So this is just an oscillation, again, the traveling wave space and time. But we now end up with a real exponential behind that. So that is a damping factor. That is something that that causes the amplitude to decrease as the wave travels. And it gets worse if you just like in your equation, if you calculate the intensity, then the exponential part of the complex imaginary parts, phase parts, drop out, and you end up with something that is that is clearly again exponentially decaying with the factor minus 2 times kappa and then k times r. This, of course, we've seen before. This is just yet another way of writing Lambert-Beer's law. This is how intensity decays as it travels, and that means that the damping factor of this exponential can be identified as the absorption coefficient or as an absorption coefficient. So we can now define mu a as 2 times k times kappa times the imaginary part of the refractive index. So that in such a way that the propagating beam is damped with this factor exponential minus mu a times r. So just be the Beer's law, in effect. So now we made the connection between so we had this complex refractive index that occurred because of Maxwell's equations, and now we identified the imaginary part of this complex refractive index with the absorption coefficient. Just again some examples. This is the absorption coefficient spectrum of water. Just to stress that these are all frequency or wavelength dependent parameters. So this is then the absorption coefficient. But you can use any of these formulas depending on the on which way you have tabulated it to convert to the imaginary part of the reflective index. These are all equivalent ways of writing it. All right. So if you now apply it to optics, then again, this causality formulation was that the optical response, sort of response to an electric field, which in this case would be the electric displacement in the material, that response cannot travel faster than the speed of light. Okay, so with these equations, that means, and again, I have yet to prove it, that the real and imaginary parts are related. They're not independent of each other. And that will mean that two seemingly different effects are going to have to be related. So let's say, start on the right hand side. You sit behind a window. If you sit behind a window that absorbs UV light, you will not get a suntan because the window absorbs UV light. But that means that the window has a certain absorption coefficient for UV light. And consequently, a certain certain imaginary part of the complex refractive index in that region. And now, what we'll see is the fact that they are related, has an effect on the real part of the refractive index. And the effect is in such a way that if you use that same glass that you made the window of, if you make a prism out of that glass, the refractive index will be such that it breaks that light, that it disperses that light. So these are two physical phenomena that seem unrelated, but they actually are related through these Gram-Schrödinger relations. I will not hold you in suspense any longer. This is how that relation looks like. This is the relation between the absorption coefficient, or not precisely imaginary part of the refractive index, but then written as an absorption coefficient already, and the real part of the refractive index. Anything that grabs your attention immediately?
I guess there's a derivative. No. I guess the capital P is unknown to me.
Yeah. Okay. The capital P is called the Cauchy principal value. If you look, so omega prime is just to be sure. So omega is the frequency at which we want to calculate the refractive index in this case, and omega prime is just the integration variable. So that does not signify a derivative. That is just the integration variable. The problem is in the denominator. That is, if omega prime is this running integration variable, at the moment it becomes equal to omega, this integral blows up, because then you're dividing by zero. And the Cauchy principal value basically tells you, signals that you're aware of that. So what you do in practice is you integrate just up to that point, and then make a little jump, and then carry on with the rest of the integration. So it is just a mathematical trick to avoid the singularity in the integral. So it doesn't stand for anything. It's kind of a symbol to let you know that this is happening. Anything else? If you look at the integration boundaries, what does that tell you? Yeah, so it kind of tells you, I guess, that this was a little bit too good to be true, because it says here that if you want to calculate the refractive index at one single frequency, you need to know the absorption spectrum at frequencies from zero to infinity to do it right. So that is of course a near impossibility. So that is a significant drawback. But we'll see that we can work around that a little bit so that we can practically use it anyway. That is kind of good news. And the way to do that is math. So here we go. Start again with this causal function that described. So I'm going to just try to run through this derivation. I have one small question/assignment in between. If I go too fast or if anything's not clear, then please interrupt me, because this is much easier to do in a real life classroom, but I want to try it anyway to see how it if it works this way as well. So this causal function describes the response. The response is R of t of the system. The input is I of t. So in a crude sketch, it would be something like this. The input starts by definition at t is zero. It may last longer, but it may also stop at some point. But causality requires that the response is zero for t is less than zero. That is, the response cannot exceed the cause. So for t is less than zero, rt, the response is zero. This one you saw already. We can express the output as one moment, close the curtain here because the sun is getting in. As this convolution integral of the response function convoluted with the input response, so t prime is now the integration variable and t is the time point at which we want to evaluate the output. So what we can do is take the Fourier transform of both sides. So R of t then becomes R omega. Capital Z of t, the response function in the frequency domain, becomes Z of omega, and the input becomes I of omega. I've used the convolution theorem here. Are you familiar with the convolution theorem? It tells you that a convolution in the time domain equals a product in the Fourier domain. So if you have if you convolve two functions in the time domain, then in the Fourier domain, it is it's the same as the product of the Fourier transforms. The other way around goes as well. If you have a convolution in the frequency domain, then it will correspond to a product in the time domain of the conjugates. If that's acceptable, I will go on. So the function z of t, the response function in the time domain, is a real function because it's a physical function. But after the Fourier transform, if you go to the Fourier domain, it can be a complex function. So we can write capital Z of omega as a real part X of omega and an imaginary part Y of omega. We could do the same exercise for the response function and for the input function. So in the time domain, these are real functions, and in the frequency domain, they are complex functions. So ZT is a real function. It is zero. For t is less than zero, and it eventually it goes to zero as t goes into infinity. So it is a system that that will if the input stops, then the system will eventually stop responding. So z of t by that consideration becomes a square integrable function. We're not going to use that much, but that's how it is. What it means practically is that means that we can mathematically multiply z of t with the Heaviside function, the step function. The step function is simply defined as zero for t is less than zero and one for t is larger, equal or larger to zero. So if we multiply z of t with this step function, then basically nothing changed because we had no signal at t less than zero. So we can do this without any problems, but that also means that if we then take the Fourier transform of the left hand side and the right hand side of this equation, we get two Fourier transforms. But because these signals are equal, then the Fourier transforms also have to be equal. So the Fourier transform of z of t, the green underlined on the left hand side, is equal to the Fourier transform of the product of z and t in this Heaviside function. That's the blue underlined part. And now I'm going to use this convolution theorem again, because now I have a product here. The left-hand side. So that says the Fourier transform of z of t. Well, we had z omega there as a symbol. And the integral that you see here is the definition, or at least the definition that I use in these slides. So z of t times e exponential omega t, and then integrate it from minus infinity to infinity over dt. Now the same thing for the for the right hand side. So this is again this convolution theorem that tells us that the Fourier transform of a product of two functions is equal to the convolution of the two individual Fourier transforms. I don't think it's a standard Fourier theorem, so I don't think it's beneficial to dwell too much upon it. So if you can just accept this, then I'll continue. If it really is a problem, then let me know. And we can write then that convolution just as in integral form again. So that means we have z omega prime multiplied with the shifted version of the Heaviside function, of the Fourier transform of the Heaviside function h omega minus omega prime, and then integrated over all space. So if you now look at the last couple of equations, that means that I used to use the tensor product. I think because I couldn't find the proper convolution. So what symbol are you used to for convolutions? I think this one is used, but. That's what's that, a big dot?
I mean, I haven't seen the convolution symbol in quite some time, so I wouldn't even know.
Oh, star. That's, yeah. Okay. Okay. Then it's supposed to be a star. I think this is the last time you'll see it. So, can you see my pointer, by the way? Yeah, you can. So that means that this Fourier transform. So that what we said in the equation with the underlines, that means that this Fourier transform here is equal to this Fourier transform over here. So we can now group these together in a moment. So this last result. So the convolution written here in integral form has the Fourier transform of the Heaviside function. So the Heaviside function was the step function in the time domain, and now in the frequency domain, h of omega is the Fourier transform of that. It looks simple, but it's very difficult Fourier transform to derive. The result, if you use the right approach, or if you find the right textbook, is this form. H of omega has a real part, which is a delta function, delta omega, and an imaginary part, which is inversely proportional to frequency. So we can use this. We can just insert this into this integral form for this convolution. So you see the substitution being made here. Z omega prime stays where it is, and then the Heaviside, the Fourier transform of the Heaviside function, is replaced with this delta and 1 over omega terms. We've used the shifted version of h in the top equation, so we use the shifted version here for the delta function and the imaginary part as well. Now we can split this. We can split this integral, and we know that if you put a delta function in an integral, it basically just selects the argument of that integral. You don't have to do that whole integral anymore. So for the real part, the delta function just selects z of omega. So that becomes, as you can see here underlined in red, half times z omega, and the other part, 1 over omega, that remains an integral part. So we can bring the complex number here to the outside of the integral, and then we have an integral here that is z omega prime, that is this z omega prime, divided by omega minus omega prime, that is this this omega prime. All right. So the first result of our Heaviside trick was that the Fourier transform of z of t was equal to the Fourier transform of this product. And that last part, the Fourier transform of this product, is what we've been calculating here now. So that means that on the left-hand side, we have the Fourier transform of z of t, which was z omega. And on the right-hand side, we have the Fourier transform of this product, which was what we had here, and is now written here. So you can see we have a z omega term on the left hand side, and we have a z omega term on the right hand side. Then of course we can bring bring that z of omega to the other side, and then we end up with this more compact expression. So we have here now z of omega, so the Fourier transform of the response function expressed as an integral equation basically of itself, of z of omega, z omega prime. This is the result of this, of basically the direct result of multiplying with this Heaviside function. Okay, now remember that z omega was a complex complex function, so we can write it in terms of its real and imaginary parts, so x omega and y omega, and we can and that means that we can split this this highlighted integral in its real and imaginary components. So on the left hand side you just see the x and y, and here within the integral we can also make that split. And then we can group the real and imaginary parts together. And you already see note here that we have a complex number here in front of the y omega, but there's also a complex number here outside the integral. So that so this y and this y are going to cancel, and here it is going to remain. So if we do the split first, so again in an in an imaginary component that is listed here first, and a real component that is given here. If we now compare or equate the real and imaginary parts into two separate equations, then this is the result. So we have x of omega, the real part of the Fourier transform of the response function, is given as an integral of the imaginary part. And vice versa. So the imaginary part is given as an integral of the of the real part. Indeed, and this is based on just because of causality, just because the response function had to be zero for t is less than zero. Because of that, and we could do this trick. It follows that the real and imaginary parts of the response function, of the Fourier transform of the response function, are related. Any objections or questions so far?
I mean, I think it's really cool that an imaginary part actually has something to do with a real life effect. Since, like, from maths, it seems kind of arbitrary, but.
Yeah, I'm gonna so we're halfway done, I guess, but the concept is here now, but now we have to now the goal is to indeed make it relatable to real life. So one of the things, and it is that again you notice from the integration boundaries, that if you want to calculate, let's say, the real value at a single value omega, then you need to know, according to this equation, you need to know the imaginary part omega from minus infinity to infinity. And that obviously puts us in a little bit in a bound, because we have no negative frequencies in the physical world. So in order to relate this to use this dispersion relations in a real world application, we have to take care of that negative frequency issue. We can make use of the fact that z of t is a real valued function. So real valued means that that it has no imaginary part. And that means that its Fourier transform z of omega, so if z of t is an it's a real valued function, then the Fourier transform z of omega is an even complex function. And an even complex function means that that you're allowed to write this. So z of omega is equal to z, so the conjugate of z star of minus omega. So in if you think of sines and cosines, then usually we define an even function as a function where f of x equals f of minus x. If you're considering complex functions, then you, conjugate also comes in. Maybe this is a little bit of a daring question, but Can you prove this statement? Just can you try together to see how far you can take this? Okay, everyone, let's continue. This is quite an annoying question, I think. Let me just show you a brief the brief few steps that that I took to show this. So let's start with an with the simply the definition of the Fourier transform. So this is the FT of the Fourier transform of Z of T is Z omega, so the integral. If I now take the complex conjugate of both sides, so on the left-hand side we get Z star of omega. That means that on the on the right-hand side within the integral, I have to take. Okay, let's compare notes later on. Then Z star of T within the integral and the complex conjugate of I omega T is I minus omega T. So this is. A little bit of manipulation. Now, if I want to calculate the if I change the sign on the omega on the left hand side, I have to do that on the right hand side as well. So that means that the minus I omega becomes I omega again, and then I have again just a Fourier transform by definition, but now this time of Z star T. So basically, the result here is that the Fourier transform of the conjugate of Z of T equals the is simply the Fourier transform Z, but then conjugated and with the argument now negative. So this is a general, this just general. Now for a real function, because it is a real function, we can equate simply the function with its complex conjugate because there is no imaginary part. So Z of T equals Z, Z star of T, and then basically, we're done because the Fourier transform of Z of T is Z omega, and the Fourier transform of Z star of T, this is what we just calculated on the left-hand side, is Z star of minus omega. This is my derivation. Do you have anything different, Jorik and Pepijn, or a different approach? You were, as I saw, you were working on the splitting it in the odd and even components.
So I've used the same approach. So maybe Ben can elaborate.
Yeah, well, let's say I started with a different approach to split it in an even and uneven parts. And then assuming that Z is real, you can drop out the sine part of the Euler relation, I think, because it is an even domain, right? Mm-hmm. Let me write a little bit more, but
I have to be careful. So if you have if you split it in an even and an odd part, then and as a sine and a and so you so you split the e omega in a sine and an cosine transform.
Yeah,
I think.
A real cosine and a
and the sine for the
for the
so you can do the same thing with the signal with Z of T. And then what you get is the products, so the even and the odd products in if you take the integral of that, that evaluates to zero because they're orthogonal. Yep. And the even and the odd parts, they remain.
Yeah, that's
so I think if you follow that route, and then I think you will end up with the same answer eventually.
Yeah, I was almost there, but yeah.
Okay. Okay, maybe this is then the best time to have a break. So you can work on it a little more if you want.
Break a sweat.
Let's see. 10 minutes. Is that enough for you, or do you want longer? So let's start again at 15:50 then.
See you then.